have you, haven't you? Today's hearing is your first as Director of Immigration and Customs Enforcement, ICE. Director Saldana comes to this position from the great state of Texas. She's a fellow Texan. We'll try to be nice to her. She served as the U.S. Attorney for the Northern District of Texas. Prior to that, she served as Assistant U.S. Attorney and prosecuted a variety of criminal cases, including human trafficking, public corruption, and bank and mortgage fraud. Director, you have a challenging job. Enforcing immigration and customs laws and investigating and dismantling transnational criminal organizations isn't easy. Pardon me, but it is essential. We look forward to working with you and all the men and women at ICE and encourage you to keep us as well informed as you can of all operations. All in all, the President's budget request for ICE is pretty good. Overall spending is at $6.3 billion, which is $16 million below fiscal year 2015. As required by law, the request includes $2.4 billion for 34,040 detention beds, of which 31,280 are for adult detention and 2,760 are for families. $122 million is for alternatives to detention to monitor an estimated 53,000 aliens, and funds sufficient to cover the cost of 6,200 criminal investigators and 5,800 deportation officers and immigration enforcement agents. Though these recommendations are sound, I have a few concerns. First and foremost, the budget assumes funding for 100% staffing, yet according to preliminary budget analysis, the number of onboard investigative staff is far lower than budgeted. Whether they can be hired before the end of the fiscal year is questionable. In fact, I wonder whether you can spend the funds appropriated in fiscal year 2015 appropriations package. Next, I am pleased that the request assumes funding for 34,040 detention beds as mandated by law. I'm surprised, however, that the request for 2,760 family units is 972 units lower than last year. Last September, the administration requested funds for 3,732 new family detention units, and Congress provided appropriations to that level. Reduction indicates a portion of the funds provided in fiscal year 2015 are no longer necessary, and we need to get to the bottom of this. Before I turn to Ms. Saldana for her statement, the text of which will be included in the record, I'd like to recognize the distinguished ranking member, Ms. Roble Allard, for any remarks that she may wish to make.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and good morning, Director Saldana, and congratulations on your confirmation as director, and welcome to your first appearance before this subcommittee. The fiscal year 2016 net discretionary budget request for U.S. Immigration and Customs Enforcement is $5.97 billion, which is a slight increase of $6.3 million above the fiscal year 2015 level. The total includes $345 million for 2,760 family detention beds, which is nearly 20% of the overall detention budget. And this extremely costly proposition is one of the issues which I'll be asking you about this morning. Also, when the Secretary testified before the subcommittee a few weeks ago, I mentioned to him that the toughest mission for the Department is the enforcement of our immigration laws because it exposes a tension among values we as Americans hold dear, such as obeying the law, protecting children, and keeping families together. While I realize we cannot open our borders to everyone who wants to come here for a better life, I do believe that it is important to keep those values in mind. And this will help to ensure that as we discuss your agency's immigration enforcement mission, we do so in the context of ensuring individuals are treated humanely and afforded due process under our laws. ICE has many areas of responsibility where it deserves credit for its performance, and I would just like to highlight a few of those. Last year, ICE dismantled 8 alien smuggling organizations involving the arrest of 37 smugglers. ICE also identified and provided assistance to 446 human trafficking victims and more than 1,000 child exploitation victims. And just last week, among other things, ICE announced the arrest of 19 individuals wanted for murder and 15 for rape. As I mentioned earlier, however, there are areas where I have significant concerns, such as the exorbitant cost of family detention beds. Other areas I would like to discuss have to do with how ICE is making use of alternatives to detention and the status of implementing and adhering to the agency's revised enforcement priorities. I also hope we will have time this morning to focus on your important investigative missions, most of which are not directly related to immigration enforcement, including human trafficking and child exploitation. So thank you again for being here, and I look forward to our discussion this morning.
All right, Director, we now will recognize you for a summation of what you have submitted to the committee in approximately 5 minutes, if you can.
Thank you, sir. And I don't seem to have a working thing, but that's not unusual, I guess. Somebody will hit me with a hammer or something.
The button, pushing the button. It should light up green when you're ready to talk. That work?
Can you hear me? I mean, I don't think it's going to be hard to hear me.
Take your mics on.
Okay. Thank you, sir. You're right, this is my first appearance before this committee. I was just with Judiciary yesterday, and we had some lively conversation. I think I'm prepared for you all today. I will thank the Judiciary Committee later. From my early days as an assistant United States attorney, just cutting my teeth on the immigration docket, to the time that I've spent here, a little bit short of 4 months, as the director of ICE, I have seen firsthand over these several years, the commitment, dedication, and hard work shown by the agents, the international staff, the lawyers, mission support staff, all our folks at ICE, and am very, very proud to be serving as the director. I get kidded a lot about that, but I will tell you that this is the place I should be right now in this critical moment in our history. As you all know, ICE has about 400 laws we have to enforce. As a U.S. attorney, I had about 3,000 plus that I had to enforce in the North Texas area. I appreciate the importance of the mission of ICE, Homeland Security, national security, enforcement of customs laws, smuggling activities, transnational crime. And I know that you all do as well, and I'm really looking forward to a productive relationship, because that's why I am here, is because I'd like to attempt, in the short time I have, to do the best I can for the country and for this agency, which I'm very proud to lead. I'm pleased with our 2016 budget submission of $6.28 billion. It's very much in line with the 2015 enacted budget, for which we are very, very grateful. Following years of sustained and painful budget cuts, as well as the threat of sequestration and shutdowns, you all can imagine how difficult it has been to manage our finances. But now with this budget, I think it'll strengthen our financial footing to enable ICE to expand efforts that are core to its mission, including immigration, the transnational crime and investigations you spoke about, a ranking member, Roy Vallard, and investment in information technology needed to meet the security challenges of this 21st century. These areas, along with the improvement of morale at our agency, actually parallel my own goals for the agency, and I am very much focused on cybersecurity in Homeland Investigations and counterterrorism work, and focusing our efforts on those people who are immigrants, undocumented immigrants in the country, who pose a threat to our communities. So as the principal investigative arm of the department, the Office of Homeland Security Investigations, we refer to it as HSI, does do criminal investigations to protect the United States against terrorism and other criminals, and to bring to justice those seeking to exploit our customs and immigration laws worldwide. Notably, in 2014, ICE investigations led to the disruption or dismantlement of 520 transnational criminal organizations, and I cannot tell you how impressed I am. I've now visited 6 countries in the less than 4 months that I've been on board, including going around the world. I did go around the world on one trip and live to tell about it. And I'm just so impressed with our international people, our attachés, our deputy attachés, and the tremendous support they bring to our investigations. It's critical to have those folks out there, obviously, as well as our domestic agents. In connection with those investigations, we made more than 32,000 criminal arrests and seized more than 2.3 million pounds of narcotics, 23,000 weapons, and $722 million in currency, aligned with our financial investigations. The President's budget requests $1.99 billion for ICE to continue these investigative efforts. Specifically, the budget increases domestic investigative capacity to hire special agents and investigative support staff, an area that's very critical. And I do understand your concerns, Mr. Chairman, with respect to the hiring, and that's an area that is of utmost importance to me. We're up and running and have interviews and other things already in effect, and we will, and I will happy to fill you in more in more detail. The budget also requests $26 million additional dollars for human smuggling and human trafficking, which is an area that I prosecuted substantially when I was an assistant United States attorney. To prioritize the removal of those living lawfully and unlawfully in the United States, ICE devotes its resources to areas that hold the highest risk to our communities. In 2014, I think you've seen the numbers, we removed 316,000 individuals unlawfully present in the United States. More than 213,000 of these were apprehended while or shortly after attempting to cross our borders, and 102,000 were apprehended in the interior of the United States. I should point out that 85% of those interior removals were of immigrants previously convicted of criminal offenses. That's an 18% increase over prior years, 2011 in particular, and it reflects the agency's renewed focus on aggressively targeting and removing the worst criminal immigrants. Security threats, felons, gang members, and the like. This budget for 2016 requests $3.3 billion to deter illegal entry into the United States with full funding for the 34,040 beds you mentioned, Mr. Chairman, including family units, 129 fugitive operation teams, a very important part of what we do, and increased use of alternatives to detention that effectively manage risk while also reducing the detention costs the ranking member mentioned earlier. Of course, the other side of this coin is the work of our attorneys, whose work is vital to moving cases along so that we can remove people, so we can get a final order and a disposition with respect to those people we want to see removed, and the attorneys are vital in that. With the new attorneys that we're requesting, we think we can address their very heavy workloads and decrease the average length of stay of detainees, which, as you all know, can get very expensive very quickly. The 2016 President's budget also requests $73.5 million to improve ICE's information technology infrastructure and applications. It is old. Obviously, part of our, we want to, in order to manage, I have to review data all the time. In order to oversee our operations, you all need to review data all the time. And this $73.5 million is critical. Due to reduced budgets and sequestration, ICE's capital investment budget has decreased by 71% from a high of $90 million in 2010 to $26 million this year. Some of the systems are reaching the end of their life, while others need to be modernized to improve interoperability, data sharing, and reporting capabilities to you and to the American people. I can't emphasize enough how critical investing in our information technology is for our investigative enforcement capabilities. Just want to conclude by thanking you for your continued support, and I am ready to answer any questions you may have.
Well, thank you, Ms. Saldana, for that summation. We appreciate it very much, and I'm going to start out by jumping off into a subject that is weighing upon my heart pretty heavily, and I would hope most of the members, if not all the members of this subcommittee. It has been reported in the press to this committee that 30,558 individuals with criminal convictions were released into the public arena in the United States of America. This is a 2014 release, which follows a 2013 release, which was the subject of a discussion this subcommittee last year, of 36,000 criminal aliens released, at which time we ask, Why didn't you tell us about this, and why don't you tell us now about the nature of these people? We got that some months later after we requested it. We wrote into our bill report language requiring the ICE to give us that information prior to release. And by the way, this has been a policy, it's my understanding, talking to prior staff people, that's been around, we have asked for a long time. If you're going to release known criminal offenders into the public arena and into the neighborhoods of American citizens, we think that this committee who pays the bills should get that information prior to release. And we treat report language as a direction from this committee for the performance of the agency we direct. This is not hard stuff. You read law books, you know, if it's there in print, you know what it says. I know you're new to the game, but let me just tell you a pet peeve I have about the entire Homeland Security Department. I no longer have any sympathy for the excuse that, well, the acting director was taking care of that before I got here. Half the people in DHS are acting. It's a fatal flaw of this department, and I have addressed this with Jay Johnson, and he agrees it's a fatal flaw. And I'll have to give him some credit about putting in the fast track to get people to be the actual people responsible for these agencies in place. And I'm no longer going to accept the excuse that the acting director should have taken care of this. And no, you take all the faults of the guy that was running the ICE before you got there. And we expect to know this information. Now, you're a Texan, and you know that the NAFTA corridor is the outlet for the entire eastern part of the United States, and it runs right through our backyard. You went to school in Kingsville, it runs right through your backyard. The Texas people conceive that we have just put 30,000 criminals that they know nothing about on that highway headed north. Now, it's not, in reality, they're not all on that highway, but there's a good number of them that are. They run right through my hometown of Round Rock. That corridor affects every Texan in the whole state. And when people hear criminals are released, they get fearful. And they ask us to answer for that because we are their representatives. And if the subcommittee that provides the funding doesn't have the information, then none of the rest of the members of Congress have any source to go to get the information. This is a critical era, and I have a whole series of questions that I want to discuss with you about that. Let me start here. There are, and these, you just kind of make a little note of this, and I'll go by sections. Are there national security concerns or law enforcement sensitivities that prevent you are the department to give us from giving us this information? Why does the press get it before Congress gets it? As directed in FY15 House report, do you intend to publish the information on your website as directed by Congress, and when? Let's start with those three questions.
Okay. And sir, when I took the oath for this office, it was never my intention, and will not be my pattern, to blame others for the situation at ICE. I'm here voluntarily of my own free will, and I intend to answer for the agency. With respect to the information and the reporting, My boss, Jay Johnson, as you well know, is very demanding with respect to our cooperation and providing of information to our committees and members of Congress. He has a very clear directive to all of us that we should do that. I will tell you that right now we are working on the very report. I think late last month I issued a memorandum and directive that would give me greater comfort because I have the same concern. I don't want criminals who are threats to our communities out there either. What I've asked for is I want more supervision of the decisions that are made with respect to criminal releases, just so that we can rest assured that we're going about our process and following it faithfully and consistently across the country. And one of the things that I addressed in there was the communication with state and local government, obviously with the Congress, but with state and local governments in particular, before we release a person with a serious criminal history into the community. We are working on that. I mentioned the technology money. Sir, I know little about IT. I just don't have that kind of brain. I'm a lawyer after all. But I do understand old and outdated information systems. And as you can well imagine, we're getting lots and lots of inquiries from, the 92 or so committees that oversee our operations. And many of them have different aspects. What we're trying to do is to create a system that can be more responsive. And we are on the task of the national and the local and state communications of releases. We are already in the test pilot stage, trying to make sure that we can communicate with the state systems, which in turn will provide information to the local jurisdictions. And I believe those early tests are coming back very successful. In terms of expanding it nationally, it's going to take a few more months in order for us to get that in a way that we can push a button, provide that information to the state, and bring it back so that people have an idea of who's going into their communities that have a record of criminal history. The estimate I've seen is at least through probably the end of this calendar year before we can get that up and going. But I know we're talking to particularly state information systems, which we have in Texas and obviously the other states have, so that we can make our systems compatible so they can speak to each other. I'm sorry, I don't know the technical jargon, but I do understand systems speaking to each other. And that's what we're trying to accomplish. That's a big deal to me. That's a big deal to me. I know it's a big deal to you, sir, and to the other members of this committee, and I am going to be on it. I am going to be on it from here until we get to the end of actually making this a working system. With respect to reporting to this committee, the people behind me have very clear direction that this is a top priority, is communicating with congressional staff and with members of Congress. And trying to get, we pedal as fast as we can. I have seen it when there's a response and a request. And I think we've made very good progress. I think we've cut down the numbers, the turnaround time on inquiries, and that's another thing I have my finger on the pulse of. So that's where we are, and I commit to you that we will continue to do that, and I will stay on it until we get good.
Well, Ms. Saldana, when I heard what you were asking, when you commented about, in fact, I made a little note at the top of my page that I expected to hear, and I did, data. Okay, it's wonderful, the new tools we have. But as far as we're concerned, you can sit down with a pencil and a Big Chief tablet and write us out a list of the people that are being released from prison, because you can't release them without being able to inform somebody to turn them loose. So somebody knows this information that works for ICE, and they have been directed by us prior to the release and prior to anything going to the press that we get that information. I don't care whether it comes on a computer. You can write it on a big chief tablet and send it over here. But I expect it to be here. I think it's only fair that those of us who have to take the major amount of heat that will come down and is coming down right now in our communities across the United States, that, you know, I was a judge for 20 years. We didn't have all these fancy things. We used IBM Selectric typewriters and carbon paper at one time in the courthouse. It's still available. There's no excuse to just ignore it because our computer doesn't work as fast as it needs to or doesn't do accumulate the information, because you have human beings that are accumulating that information, and they can send it to us.
Let me be clear, Chairman. We're not ignoring it. We're on this.
Well, we don't have it.
These are files. These are files with a bunch of paper in them. They're stored centrally in archives in a central location. We have to get them. Somebody, as you said, has to get with a pencil and a tablet and go through and respond to the different facts that you're asking for. So we are on that.
So are you telling me that these people are released without them informing you or the top echelon? Just that this is field work that's done by individuals, and they're just making these releases without any central authority at all?
That's part of that same directive I told you about earlier. They are making decisions locally, but I have asked for additional levels of review, and that is the field office director, the person who runs the enforcement and removal operation locally, has been told, you need to sign off. You or an assistant needs to sign off on this, that extra level of supervision. I've created a 5 or 6 person panel of senior managers who will look at the release and make sure we're exercising, to the extent we're exercising our discretion, and this isn't a court-ordered release, that they review it as well. So, no, it's not happening in a vacuum. But we will get that information.
Any people in that chain of command you just mentioned should be able to give us the information. And if it comes in piecemeal, that in the Rio Grande Valley we're turning loose 10,000, and, you know, in Laredo we're turning through loose 20,000, I don't care how it comes down.
Okay.
But we need to know it, know what the criminal activity they were convicted of. I was a district judge. We tried felony DWIs, and, you know, amazingly enough, one of the things that kept you up at night is that drunks kill people in cars. And you get a guy that's got a felony DWI in Texas, he's had probably 5 misdemeanors before he ever gets to see you, even though he could have less to get there, but most of them about 5 or more. And when you put them out on some kind of release, you think, you know who's going to get blamed when a little kid gets run over by this drunk? It's going to be the judge that turned him loose. Well, we get blamed on this situation because we're the guys that pay the bills. And I just cannot impress upon you that I am furious about the fact we asked politely, then we put it in writing and said, you will do this, and it's not being done. That encourages us to not be very kind to the agency. And I happened to be one and told Jay Johnson and the former director that I think ICE is one of the best law enforcement agencies in the country, and they don't get any credit for it. But if you're not going to get credit, if this committee gets down on you, I can promise you, this subcommittee pays the bills and we're responsible for it. What mechanisms does ICE use to ensure sexual predators released from ICE custody meet the legal requirements to register with local officials? If these releases are being made like you described, it really, even my concern doubles. Does ICE determine whether sexual predators in ICE custody are properly registered before releasing them to the public? It is a requirement of the law of every state in the country. And there's a federal register for sexual predators that I happen to have written the legislation to put that in place. And all that is required because is a way we keep track of a lot of people who do a lot of harm to a lot of little kids. Does ICE have an official process to inform local officials that sexual predators are being released? If not, should a formal process be instituted immediately? Should the law be amended to require this formal process? If you're not, won't do it with any other thing, then we will do that.
That's the system I mentioned earlier, that I believe we can get off and running with the state databases. before the end of the year. I'm very hopeful for that. Again, this takes ginning up not only our machines, but having them link and work with the state machines as well. We're very much on that, and that includes all these criminals that are released, not just the sexual predators.
But the sexual predators, we have specific, in all 50 states, we have specific requirements for registration of sexual predators, and we have a national register.
Right.
And if we're releasing people that should be on those registers, then, you know, that's the way people, a lot of people in this modern day and age, when they get ready to buy a house, they check that list to see who their neighbors are. This is important. You've stated that you are concerned that releasing criminal aliens could cause public safety concerns. I believe the law enforcement officials should be notified when criminal aliens convicted of violent offenses are released in local communities. Does ICE inform local law enforcement about violent criminal aliens released in their communities? Are there efforts, are there effective methods for getting this information to local law enforcement? And if you're telling me there are none, is what you're saying.
No, well, there's not
a
system.
We're trying to put it in place.
We're trying to institutionalize it. But let me not fail to mention that, obviously, we're in the field. Our people are talking to state and locals all the time, sheriffs, to local officials. There's an informal communication with respect to that. I want to see it institutionalized, and that's what we're trying to do, is actually set up a system where it happens every time we release somebody.
Well, you're a lawyer. There should at least be something in writing given to notify local law enforcement. If the informal is running into a sheriff's deputy at the cafe and say, oh, by the way, we turn loose a violent criminal sexual predator over in your neighborhood, that's not the kind of notice should be available. You should be at least giving them something in writing, informing them as we do between counties, between states, these days, every day. Finally, one of the reasons for the release we hear is the Zavidas Davis decision. How many serious criminal offenders were released under a ruling of Zavidas versus Davis decision, which prohibits ICE from detaining criminal aliens longer than 6 months unless there is a reasonable assurance the individuals will be expatriated to his or her country of origin in the foreseeable future. How many of the criminal aliens released in 2013 and 2014 were released under Zavidas? What countries are they from? And why would the countries not take them back? That is very important. Because if we have countries that are not honoring their bringing their people back, then as we deal with the State Department budget and we deal with foreign affairs budgets, we have methods whereby we can get their attention that, you know, if you think that we're going to continue to provide foreign aid to your country when you won't take back these people that are a burden upon our society, and they are and have been, by being incarcerated, they're a burden on our society. You know that.
And we provided that information for 2013. We're in the process of gathering that for 2014, the breakdown by countries. I can tell you that China's pretty much at the top of the list.
Well, we know China's at the top of the list. But we have other questions. You know, Honduras and Guatemala and San Salvador, that's been a big issue. We don't know whether they're taking them back or not.
They are, sir.
Well, that's good. Okay, but that's exactly the kind of information that should be a current event for this thing, this committee, not a after-the-fact report. The current event is important to the communities that we represent. And are there steps DHS and the State Department can take with any of the nations that to get them to encourage repatriation? You got ideas? We're willing to do them. We are in this together, but you got to share information with us.
It is gratifying to hear that. I mean, that's what I
Jay
want.
Jay Johnson knows that, and I want you to know it. But you have no idea how mad people get when they hear about these releases. And the reality is most of these releases are totally appropriate. They would fit into any criminal justice system that we operate under in the country. But that's not what it sounds like. It sounds like ICE turned them loose. That's what it sounds like.
And I appreciate the fact that you're, I presume, out there telling them that information, and that's why this information obviously is important.
And just think, you know, you've dealt with locals. The local chief of police gets a call. Hey, ICE turned loose. How many of them are coming our way? How many are coming our town? The sheriff gets that call. Local law enforcement, they get the heat from this immediately as it hits the paper. They want to know where these people are. And I'll tell you, Texans think 95% of them are in our state. And it could be that a lot of them are.
It'll be a good number. I don't know about 95% between California and Texas.
This is a crisis as far as this committee is concerned, in my opinion.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Director Saldana, in addition to last year's influx of unaccompanied children, there was a rapid growth in the number of families crossing the border, usually mothers with one or more children. And ICE responded by establishing a significant number of new family detention beds. In fact, the number of family beds will have gone from around 85 at this time last year to what is expected to be more than 3,100 by June. For FY16, the budget proposes $345 million for 2,760 family detention beds, and that's $125,000 per bed, including care. In addition to the high cost, many of us are concerned about the prospect of so many families, especially children living in detention settings. Since there are less expensive and more humane options, such as alternatives to detention, which have proven to be successful in having people show up for their court hearings, it seems that the real issue to be addressed is the speed at which someone is able to have their case adjudicated before an immigration judge. So given that the $345 million proposed for family detention next year is almost three-fourths of the entire budget proposed for the immigration courts at DOJ, wouldn't it make more sense to use that money to address the immigration backlog at DOJ?
Well, you noticed, Representative, that we also asked for an increase in alternative detention programming because we have found some success in that. I think we've had requests before, but none. This is about the highest we've asked for. So we are definitely looking at that and think that's particularly appropriate for families. As you know, there's a district court decision that talks about the fact that we should not use deterrence as a factor in making decisions with respect to the families. And so we have gone back and scrubbed prior cases, and every person, adult or family member, the decisions are being made on the basis of the due process you talked about earlier. Is a bond more appropriate for this individual? Do we need to detain them? If there's a bond that's appropriate, what's the appropriate amount to make sure that they appear in future court proceedings? So we are very sensitive to that. I agree with you. I made it a point in month two to go to the Dilley family facility and see for myself, because I'm one of these trust but verify people, that facility, I don't know if you've had an opportunity to visit it, but that is one of the three and the largest of the three family facilities. Is, in my opinion, top-notch. It provides infant care, child care, education, medical facilities. I think the response time is within 12 hours. Someone's had a medical examination to see what their needs are and the like, and I am very much satisfied that that's appropriate. I plan to go to Carnes because I've heard a lot about Carnes. And I want, again, to see for myself. I think I've planned a trip for that, actually, tomorrow or the day after. I'm going somewhere.
Okay. I think that my question has to do more with the issue of if we need these family detention beds, and one of the primary reasons is that the length of time it takes for a case to be adjudicated, and we are spending $125,000 per bed, you know, plus care. If it wouldn't make more sense then, given that that the cost of the detention is three-fourths that of the entire budget proposed for DOJ, wouldn't it make more sense then to use that money to help expedite the adjudication of these cases? That's my...
I cannot urge you more that we need both, in my view. We need more judges, because that is actually the underlying problem. I think the chairman mentioned it earlier. We have got to move the process faster. We don't detain because we get a kick out of it or it's something that's good to do. We detain based on any decision that a federal judge makes, for example, with respect to releasing someone pending proceedings. And that's flight risk and safety issues. So, yes, it could be a simplistic answer, but my view is that we need those additional attorneys that I talked about. DOJ, I don't know why I'm speaking for DOJ other than it was my prior department. DOJ needs those additional judges that they're going to be requesting, I'm sure, for 16, so that we can get those decisions that the families are asserting their request for relief made sooner rather than later. That'll save us on all of these costs. Right now, we don't know how many families are going to be coming in or whether we have anything close to what happened last time. We've got the beds ready. That was our promise, is to have those beds ready if that happens again this year. We will see. I think we're just coming upon that part of the season that there tends to be more migration towards this area. So I would strongly suggest that both things need to be done.
Okay. Let me go back. You mentioned the bonds, and I understand that the district court has imposed a preliminary injunction on the ICE policy of detaining families seeking asylum without consideration of releasing them on bond. Can you explain what the rationale was behind this policy, given that the bond is an incentive for ensuring that families appear at immigration hearings?
If we're talking about the district court, Washington, D.C. court, that is not the ruling of the court. The ruling of the court, as I understand it, it's been a little while since I've looked at it, is that we cannot take deterrence, which is the reason we specified for detaining families, is one of the factors we were looking at, is deterring other families from coming through was not appropriate, and we are prohibited from doing it. That.
This was the U.S. District Court.
Right, in D.C.
Right. Okay. Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh.
You're right.
And so, no, bonds are afforded to families, just like any other adult that we look at. We give them, if we make the decision that we don't need to detain them, we give them that opportunity for a bond, again, to ensure their presence in the future.
That's currently, yeah, that's true based on decision. But prior to that is my understanding that families that were seeking asylum were not given the consideration of bond, and that leads me to the next part of my question, that there has been some complaints that while ICE has begun to offer bond to some families, that the amount is often set too high for families to afford. So what is ICE's process in setting bond amounts, and is the affordability of the bond taken into account on a case-by-case basis?
It is definitely a case-by-case analysis of the factors. The minimum bond that can be set is $1,500. I would think even $1,500 for some families would be impossible to meet. But that's a bottom line figure. My understanding is that we look at, again, it's a decision that's made on a case-by-case basis. What bond amount will ensure this person actually shows up? I don't have an example right now I can give you, and I wouldn't talk about individual cases anyway, but in generally, that's the approach. It's not, let's set the bond so they can't make bond. It's, let's set the bond based on a number that will ensure they will appear in the future.
So is there an appeal process?
Absolutely. It's on our website, lower right-hand corner, and also everybody has the right to appeal to an immigration judge on the amount of bond that is imposed on an individual, and many, many do. One of the reasons we have a 500,000 person backlog in the immigration courts.
You mentioned Carnes, and some detainees at the Carnes Family Residential Center engaged in a hunger strike to protest their detention while seeking asylum. Do you know if the participants have been offered release on bond, and if so, has the bond amount been set at a level that they could afford and it's they're using it?
All of the persons who come into our custody are given a bond determination very quickly. And yes, all of them are. One thing I strongly suggest, Congresswoman, is if you're relying on the New York Times story that came out this weekend, it is chock full of errors, not the least of which is that we have barbed wires in our family detention center. And there are about 16 or 18 other facts that are wrong there. I've asked, when I meet with non-governmental organizations, I've asked, if you have a complaint, there's a process on our website. But more importantly, please get the facts, information that we can look at, the names of people, the dates events were apparently occurred or are alleged to occur, because facts are more important to me than assertions that are just thrown out there willy-nilly. We will look at anything that looks wrong, and as I say, I personally am going to Carnes tomorrow, apparently, or the next day, and we'll look into that. But no, every person has an opportunity for a bond determination if we believe there's not a recommendation on detention. Even our detention decisions are often taken on a look by the immigration courts or overturned.
Okay, well, just one final thing. It's my understanding that there have been allegations of mistreatment of hunger strikers at Carnes in retaliation for their protests, and the Department's Office of Civil Rights and Civil Liberties has begun an investigation. Is that correct, and can you provide any information on the status of that investigation?
I can do that in another setting.
Okay.
For you. We can talk about that.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. You've been very generous with the time.
Mr. Friedenhausen.
Madam Secretary, good morning. I've read that tens of thousands of people have been killed in Mexico, which borders Texas, and some of those people have been killed are U.S. Law enforcement and other citizens. You've been a prosecutor, so you've worked for the Department of Justice. You have this new role, which we congratulate you on. I'm told, and tell me if I'm wrong, that some of those who perpetuated these crimes, heads of cartels, actually have domiciles in the United States, property in the United States. As a resident of Texas, I would assume you'd know that. And what are we doing about it if that is the case?
Well, I don't know. When you refer to these crimes and tens of thousands
crimes,
of law enforcement.
Crimes involving the killing of tens of thousands of people in Mexico, to include some Americans.
There are awful and large and well-established drug cartels who have connections not only to
What I'm asking is I understand that some of the people who are involved in leadership positions are domiciled in the United States. What are you doing in your agency to prosecute or bring some of these people's behaviors to public account?
That is a big part of what Homeland Security
investigation. What are you doing? Well, what is the role of your agency relative to such people?
That is,
they come here, don't they? So they must pass through your portals. Is that right?
Through our portals.
Yes, your agency.
Yes. Well, Customs and Border Protection, you know, we have two sister agencies.
Okay.
Who worries about the borders and is apprehending the people. The people they apprehend constitute about 60%
What's your role relative to your agency relative to these people?
It's investigations, and that is gathering intelligence, interviewing witnesses, finding evidence.
Could you assure the committee that you're actually doing it, and what would be the likely consequence of some of the investigations that have already occurred?
Well, I think
where
I
do
mentioned
we stand?
Statistics.
Is it accurate that there are people here in our country that have perpetuated these crimes, that are domiciled here, that own great ranches and properties here?
That is
and transit back and forth. on a regular basis.
That is the case.
But what many are we
them
doing
are subjects,
about it?
Many of them are the subjects of investigations, not only by HSI, Homeland Security Investigations, our folks, because that's the heart of what we do is transnational criminal activity, but also by other agencies, including the FBI and DEA. All of us are out there.
So what product has come from those investigations?
I think I mentioned some statistics earlier.
But have some of these people, they're not that many of them, who have cached their behavior in Mexico through, you know, their cartel activities, making a lot of money, which the chairman, thank you for yielding. What are you doing about it?
Well,
I know there's some shared responsibilities, but what specifically would you acknowledge that this exists?
Yes, situation of
domicile exists?
I know that
exists?
Not for my 3 months at ICE, but as a United States attorney.
So what has been done? What was
for
been
those
done
who we have not captured, and we've captured quite a few, and I'm talking about the United States.
Yeah.
HSI can't take credit for all of them.
Yeah.
But we've captured quite a few. They're way up there on the list of
yeah,
people.
Yeah, but I mean they're right here. They transit back and forth.
They go back and forth, sir.
So
they go back and forth.
We've captured, you know, a dozen or?
The United States, I can't speak for the United States. I think I mentioned earlier that we've actually secured 2.3 million pounds of narcotics.
Which is like, you know, in the overall trade, that's maybe a significant sum. But in reality, this trade involves a lot more than just that amount.
The dollars
involved are huge.
A lot more. And as I said, that's part of our request for increasing our Homeland Security investigations, folks, is because we want to be out there looking at this, these cases, and finding these people and gathering the evidence.
Respectfully, these people and their domiciles and locations are, generally I'm told by people I hang out with here, ours, you know, people on the panel, sometimes these people are well known and we don't do anything to prosecute them.
Well, we get one shot at the prosecution, sir, and we need to have the evidence in order to prosecute. We can't just assume or come to a federal jury with information that there's suspicions, beliefs. We've got to line up the evidence, and those cases tend to take quite a bit of investigation.
Well, with the parent, chairman's permission, I'd like to see what your win-loss record is. Either through you or your operation or the Department of Justice as to whether we've actually been successful in apprehending any of these people who bought substantial land holdings here and who educate their children here and do all sorts of things that, that undeservedly get, you know,
I no longer have any control over the Department of Justice information, but I can certainly provide you the number of drug cartels. I think someone mentioned it earlier that we've actually broken.
Yeah.
If your specific question is how many of the drug cartel investigations we have had that we have found people who have domiciles in the United States, I think we can probably dig down into some files and find
it's sort of disturbing. I think, considering the number of people that have been killed across the border. Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Madam Secretary.
Mr. Chairman, thank you so much. First of all, I want to associate myself to the comments that the chairman made at the beginning about notice. We should not be working in silos. I think we ought to be working together, and certainly that type of information to the local communities is going to be important. If somebody's going to be released in my neighborhood, I would like to know about it. So I do want to associate myself to the comments that the chairman made. I guess Ronnie left already, but I think he has a point, and we can talk about it in another setting. To the point that the chairman of the defense was talking about a few minutes ago. That's in another setting. I would like to follow up on those points about some of those folks living on the U.S. because they know that the violence is not on the U.S., but they do their work and they come over and we can talk about that.
Okay, thank you.
I do want to also mention my brother, who's a border sheriff, Martin, I think John knows him very well. Has done some work with your folks on those online predators. And they've done a great job working together. So I just want to say Janice Ayala and the other folks here have just done a great job on the online predators. So I do want to say that to start off with. I do want to point out something that I've been talking to Chairman John Cobleson, in fact, just yesterday. The numbers that we got at the end of 2014, the Executive Office of Immigration Review that overviews the nation's immigration courts, they said they had about 429,520 cases pending. I think a lot of the issues that we're talking about, I know it's not, usually we talk about adding more officers on the border, but if we add some of those judges, I think it can move the backlog and it would really save the taxpayers a lot of money. And I've talked to the chairman there that that has the power on the Commerce and Justice, and hopefully he would look at this very carefully on that, because we do need to have more judges, and hopefully they can be placed at the border also on that, because I can give you the numbers. Yes, strategically is the key, strategically. I do want to say I'm familiar with the Corinth facility, familiar with the Dilley. I haven't gone to Dilley. All I ask you, I know my office has been working with you all about having some nuns that wanted to go. I know the bishops were there, Sister Mary Welch. I know there's some media from the Valley that dealt with a lot of this issue last summer, and we're working with you that they want to go in and work with you. We would appreciate it so there can be some sort of transparency on it. I know it's private contractors, but you all do the oversight.
Oh, yes, and I met with religious leaders, and I believe she was there at the White House, at the Executive Office Building last week, and they had already been there, and their view is that we should not detain any families. That's what they would prefer to see, and that's clear. They've made that clear to the secretary and to me, and we'll.
And we respectfully disagree. I think we need to have detentions. Otherwise, you have open borders, and I think there has to be detention. But you need to have the judges also, and other factors, and make sure there's no abuse and. You know, the issues, you know, that people are treated with respect, and y'all need to look at. But as you go and open up more of those, assume there's more of those detentions, the only thing I would ask you is to keep the taxpayers' dollars in mind. This happened before you came in. I think I called you before on this issue, and I think it's the intergovernmental service agreement. It went to one company. The amount of dollars, I don't know if the committee's familiar with it, it was in the a lot of money, I'll put it that way. And if you look at cost, it just went too much without some sort of compensation. I talked to your folks beforehand. I respectfully disagree, but there has to be at least some sort of competition so the taxpayer gets the best dollars if you're going to build a huge facility like that. But now that it's been done, I just ask you to save the taxpayers some dollars as you're going through this process. Finally, the only thing I do want to mention, I guess it's more of a statement than a question, but the communication with people that provide you funding is important. And as the chairman, I do want to finish on this. If we ask you for something, I would ask you to respond to that as soon as you can. You're new, and you got a wonderful background, and very proud of you as one of the
Javelinas
from the Texas A&I. But I just ask that y'all just keep us informed, because the worst thing that we want to see is we see this in the newspaper, and especially if we do your budget, your appropriations, a little courtesy would go a long way for having a good working relationship. So, no question, but any thoughts on what I just mentioned?
Of course, no, that, as I mentioned earlier, that's very important to me, and I think all of our, I've made very clear to all our staff here at headquarters that's very much at the top of the list, not at the very top of the list, is our communication and our responsiveness. Get the information as quickly as possible. Balance, though, Congressman, against getting accurate information. We want to report accurately, and that's why sometimes it takes a little time. We check and double check.
Oh, I just want to say thank you. I think you're going to be a good director, and we look forward to working with you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Cuellar. We're going in the order that people appeared here. So, Mr. Harris.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Madam Assistant Secretary, for coming and appearing for us. You know, ICE is kind of in the middle of a lot of the discussion about the President's new policies. And I had the opportunity to look over your biography, and I take it you were the U.S. Attorney in Texas. And I guess your role at that time really was to help enforce law. Is that right? Not policy. Is that?
To enforce the law.
Law, not policy, but law. And there's a critical distinction that is playing out in, you know, Judge Hannon's opinion about what's going on, because, you know, the distinction is whether or not the President policy, as implemented, effectively have replaced the law, which the President can't do. I mean, I hope we all should agree the President can't replace the law. And, you know, your testimony on page 3 says, and correctly, that ICE is charged with enforcing and or administering the nation's immigration laws. Now, I'm going to read you a very disturbing transcript of the President's immigration town hall meeting from February 25th, where he addresses the role of ICE. He says, quote, "We are now implementing a new prioritization," and he's obviously referring to the prioritization that it's actually laid out on the ICE website with regards to, I guess, Mr. Johnson's memoranda. He says, "There are going to be some jurisdictions, and there may be individual ICE officials or Border Patrol who aren't paying attention to our new directives." Doesn't say the law. He says the new directives. "But they're going to be answerable to the head of the Department of Homeland Security because he's been very clear about what our priorities should be." A few moments later, and I've been in the military, so I understand what he's talking about. The President says, look, the bottom line is that if somebody's working for ICE and there is a policy and they don't follow the policy, there are going to be consequences to it. Goes on to say, in the U.S. military, when you get an order, you're expected to follow it. I understand. I was in the military, and I understand what getting an order is. It doesn't mean that everybody follows the order. If they don't, they've got a problem. And the same thing is going to be true with respect to the policies that we're putting forward. Now, I read this to be that the President has directed ICE to follow policy instead of law. Now, I've got to ask you, is your interpretation different? I mean, the President, I understood, I was in the military, I knew what the consequence was if I didn't follow an order. It wasn't pleasant. I can't even imagine a person working for ICE reading this thinking, I have to follow the policy. I don't have discretion. There's no prioritization going to go on within these priorities. My discretion is removed. I have to follow that policy under the threat of the commander-in-chief in the case of the military or the head of the executive branch in the case of DHS, of saying, if they don't, they've got a problem. Now, Madam Secretary, I've got to ask you, is this the way ICE runs? Is ICE's purpose is to enforce policy, not law?
It's to enforce the law. And I will tell you that in the Secretary's November 20th memo, he made it very clear that these are priorities, but that every individual who comes before immigration and custom enforcement officials for whom we're making a decision, whether to apprehend, arrest, set bonds, whatever, is to be determined on a case-by-case basis. And there's a sentence here that I people miss this all the time, and I'm not exactly sure why. There's a sentence very clearly, these are the cards that our officers carry with them, so they have a handy-dandy little reference to keep in mind what the priorities are. Sir? Yes, have been since, you know, we completed the training in early January on these new priorities, which is when the executive actions went into effect. But it says here, if you encounter a priority alien who you believe is not a threat to national security, border security, or public safety, or believe that a non-priority alien's removal would serve as an important federal interest, you should discuss this matter with your supervisor. I personally met with every chief, we call them our lawyers out there, chief counsels, in all the districts by video, along with the directors, the field office directors, and I said, these are priorities. I made very clear this exercise of judgment on a case-by-case analysis. Even if this person does not meet a priority, and you believe or have reason to believe that person is still presents a public safety threat, it is your responsibility, and this is what we're here for, is to ensure that that person is taken into account, and then you meet with your supervisor to discuss it. It also says the opposite, and that is, if they're on here, but you don't consider them a public safety threat. It's a 72-year-old man who committed a crime in his teens and is now before you and has never had another criminal record before that, but the felony falls within the priorities, you have the ability to exercise your discretion on it. You know, there's a case in the Fifth Circuit that I followed closely myself, which is the Crane case, that challenged the ability of this kind of discretion, and the court, at least at the Fifth Circuit level, has gone with us. I'm sure that's still in litigation. We'll see how it turns out. But again, the reason that this is not replacing the law is because this essentially memorializes what I did every day as an assistant United States attorney and as the U.S. attorney, and that is exercise my discretion because I could not enforce with our skimpy little budget 3,000 plus laws that.
Sure. No, and I appreciate that, and I think that would be the right thing. The Crane case, I take it, is the one that was ruled on just a week ago, dismissed the lawsuit.
Yes.
That was overstanding, though. That wasn't over an issue of whether or not. Am I correct?
I think you're more precise than I was.
Correct. So legal standing, really. I mean, we know that has nothing to do with the basis of whether or not the president's action was legal.
But these
plaintiffs did not have the ability to have their case heard in court because of legal standing. So let's just dispense with this supporting the president's policy. So did the president get it wrong? Because I'm going to read it again. This is the president of the United States. This is the person in charge of the executive branch said, if an individual ICE official isn't paying attention to our new directives, they're going to be answerable to the head of DHS because he's been very clear about what our priorities should be.
The November 20th memo, and he was.
Right, a memo. So the president wasn't saying that we're going to ask ICE to enforce the law. It's to enforce the November 24th memo. Is that right? Basically.
Well, Congressman, you know, the law can be very lengthy. I mean, I know this personally. Reading them can give you a headache. But the law is just that. It's not intended to cover how you go about your business. I had, as the United States Attorney, I served in the Attorney General's Advisory Committee. We had to help United States attorneys flesh out what the law was through policies from the Attorney General. You flesh out what the law is, and you try to abide by congressional.
Sure, Madam Assistant Secretary, and I'm just going to, because I've overspent my time here, but I'm just going to ask you about that point. The fact of the matter is, the level three priority, this is from your testimony, the third level of priority are people who have actually had a final order of removal against them. So someone made a legal finding that these individuals are not here legally. Am I correct that they have violated the law and they're not here legally?
That's an initial, but all of these things can be appealed. But yes, that's the initial finding.
Let's be honest. What the president has said, we have individuals with legal findings against them, have clearly been found to violate the law, and the new directive says we're going to, instead of enforcing that law, which would result in their deportation, we're going to follow a directive or a policy. I'm a doctor, I'm not a lawyer. But to someone observing this says, we've already made a legal finding, and the new memorandum says, we're not going to follow the law, we're going to follow a policy or directive. And I have to tell you, as a member of the legislative branch, I take that very seriously. When the executive branch says, We have let the system run, we've made a legal finding, and now we're going to disregard the law. We're going to follow an executive branch policy or directive. And I will tell you, that was a rhetorical question. You don't have to answer that. Thank you very much, Assistant Secretary, and I yield back.
Ms. Kaptur, right? Yes, Ms. Kaptur.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I apologize. I had another hearing. I couldn't be here earlier. Secretary Saldana, thank you so very much for being with us today. You have a very hard job. I come from the northern border with Canada in northern Ohio. And I wanted to ask your help in this issue of human smuggling, particularly labor smuggling. I've spent a lot of my career engaged in this issue, largely from countries, laborers from countries south of the southwestern part of our country, and I'm appalled. As I read your testimony and some of the notes I've been given, your officers are dedicated to identifying and apprehending priority aliens. My concern are the contractors who bring them here.
Smugglers.
The smugglers on both sides of the border. And I would cordially invite you to my home community of Toledo, Ohio, where we have an organization called the Farm Labor Organizing Committee that was training a young man, 27 years old, named Santiago Cruz, to go to the fields in Mexico and to tell the farm workers that they didn't have to come under bondage, that they could come with a labor contract, that we would receive them, even their families, we would educate their children through Head Start while they were here. He was murdered. He was murdered in Monterey. There has not been prosecution at a level that there should be in that case, and some of his murders have never been found. I went down to Monterey. I've been in Congress a long time. I went down to Monterey, met with our counsel down there, and I said, look, just in the area of agriculture, Ohio receives at least 20,000 people a year who pick pickles and they pick tomatoes. They do very hard work, pick strawberries. I wouldn't want to do that job. They should be coming. We should have the same people every year if they want to come. You should know who they are. And I want you to make Ohio a pilot. We want to treat people like human beings. We respect their work and we respect them. Our government wouldn't do it. And this was not under the Obama administration, by the way. But I've been looking for someone, someplace in our government who really cares about people and people who work hard. And they're being exploited. I was down in the tobacco fields of North Carolina last year. I met a man from Guatemala who had his finger cut off, no health insurance. He owes $8,000 to one of these corrupt coyotes who brought him across the border. And I just can't believe our country allows this to go on. So I would like to cordially invite you or someone you send to my district to meet with people who are trying to help, and including me. And we have been thwarted at every turn. And I just think that those that exploit this labor have more power than we imagine, and I want to go after them. And I want a workforce that is treated fairly. We don't want to bring people in as unidentifiable aliens and all the rest of us. We want to know who they are. We want to treat them right. We want them to have a contract. And we want the same people every year if we can get them. Most of our farmers would like to have the same people. They don't want this churning that's going on in the labor force. I don't know if you can help me, but I'm making a plea to you. I would really appreciate the opportunity to have people from our region explain what has been going on at our border with people who travel very far and have rather grim prospects because of the manner in which they've been treated. Do you have any ability to deal with that labor smuggling issue?
Of course. With its, and again, our expertise is international. And when you cross the border, either the northern border or the southern border, that's where we come in, and we're pretty much the experts on that transnational criminal activity. You may have read about, or if not, I'll certainly provide you more information on Operation Coyote, which is our effort to bring to justice the smugglers, and this is where our international team comes in so essentially, and that is they give us information from the local countries where the smugglers are and are inducing and seducing people to come up to this to the country.
They have to be among the cruelest people alive.
False pretenses. And you remind me of a case I prosecuted involving a Korean smuggling ring. Can you imagine thousands of miles of carrying these women to the United States and actually telling them they could get a job and an education here? And they brought them in through Canada, actually. And had them ended up working in a bar to serve the pleasure of Korean businessmen when they were in the city of Dallas on business. And one woman, the one who actually revealed the scheme, jumped out of the second-story home of the smuggler. And this is a large operation. Obviously, there's a person here, but there's a person in Korea also. Oh, yeah. And again, as I say, this is part of the reason we're requesting this additional money with respect to the smuggling activity, the 20, I think it's 26 million, because we've had good success on breaking the backs of some of these smuggling organizations, and that's where our attachés are really helpful in making our connections with intelligence and other information in these countries. So yes, I would actually personally do not want to send anybody. I would actually like to go to Toledo and have further conversation.
We would warmly invite you. This has bothered me for so many years, and I was so angry with our government under former administrations, and we have a region that tries to treat workers well, and we need your help. So I appreciate that. I don't want to run you all over the world, but you know, when you're flying over the Great Lakes region, we will welcome you.
We will
you.
Make a stop.
And thank you. Thank you very, 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 very much. And I'll give you the name of a group your staff can look through. It's called the Farm Labor Organizing Committee, FLOC. I think its director is in the heritage of Cesar Chavez. He's a great man. He's given his whole life to this issue. And it shouldn't be so hard. It just shouldn't be so hard. And these criminals that traffic in human beings in the 21st century, it's beyond belief.
This Korean person who was the local smuggler was an LPR, a legal permanent resident. And not only did we get him 10 years in prison, but we denaturalized him and sent him back to Korea because of his involvement in this international smuggling activity with these young Korean women.
You'll have a support from this member on a coyote program.
Thank
with
you.
The finest investigators and the finest security people you can put to work. And again, we invite you to, I'd like you to hear directly from those that have been involved in this. And that young man, his mother, I had to go down to Mexico and be a part of a group to help her endure his loss. And to think that, you know, he was trying to treat people fairly and well, and he was so young. And the manner in which he was murdered and so forth was so brutal. I just also want to say that on the ICE front, and I'm sure my time is up, but in my region, we're not like Mr. Cuellar's district. You know, we're up north, we're on the Great Lakes. And some of the ICE personnel that come up there are rather inappropriate in the way that they follow people around in our region, in cities like Lorain, West Cleveland. I don't know exactly what can be done about that, but it seems to me that you have to be community sensitive also, and we have local attorneys willing to work with ICE at the local level to try to support in the DACA and DAPA programs individuals who many times are stopped and they didn't do anything wrong. They have green cards. They're here legally, and yet they're followed. I don't know why all that happens. I think it's just because it's such a difficult job. But it seems to me that there could be a more appropriate community approach in some of these places. And we'll probably, if you are kind enough to come to our region, we'll want to discuss that a little bit with some of the victims of rather ham-handed approaches to following individuals who shouldn't be followed.
Well, I'll tell you that it would be helpful to get more information from you with respect to that, and, yeah. and I'm happy to meet with non-governmental organizations, too, to talk to them about
thank you.
Our new approach.
Thank you very much, and thank you, Mr. Chairman. You've been generous with the gavel.
Thank you, Ms. Kapner. Mr. Young is next, but he's willing to, because Mr. Stewart has a real crisis, he's willing to yield to Mr. Stewart. So, Mr. Stewart.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I wouldn't call it a crisis, but I do have another appointment. So thank you, and Mr. Young, thank you for ceding your time. And I will be brief. Madam Director, welcome. You've got kind of a tough job. It's not one that I envy. I want to tell you a little bit about my background because it brings me to the topic which I have a real emotional attachment to, and that is before I came to Congress, I was a writer. One of the books I wrote was with Elizabeth Smart, telling her story of being captured and held, and that got me involved with another community in the West, who, and primarily in Utah, but it's not the only place, but these guys will, they're former Special Forces soldiers and other law enforcement officials that pose as businessmen. They go to foreign lands and pretend to be involved in the trafficking of children, and they rescue these children. Dozens at a time, last month, something like 50 of them. Young girls, and in some cases boys, who are being sold into sex trafficking. The crisis that we faced last summer, to use a word that we use often, but I think it certainly applies here, are these unaccompanied children that were crossing the border in numbers we had just simply never seen before. And I would ask you, I think I know the answer, but I'm going to say this, and you can say, yes, that's about right. In 2012, the number of unaccompanied children was 27,000 or something like that. 2013, 44,000. Last summer, 68,000. Now, I'm not a mathematician, but just doing it out the back of my head, that's about a 60% increase every year. And I have two concerns, and then I'll get to my question. The first concern is I believe the administration's policies, fairly or unfairly, create the impression that if these young children can get to the border, not even cross the border, in some cases surrender at the border, that they're going to be allowed to stay here. And because we have not done a great job of communicating and also having policies that I think actually foster that misconception, we're endangering the lives of tens of thousands of young children. But the primary thing I want to ask you is this. With this human trafficking, do you know what percentage of these unaccompanied children were involved in, say, drug cartels, were involved or associated in some way, were being exploited, or were sold or traded or given into some of these human trafficking, or these individuals who deal with the sex trade of unaccompanied children?
As you know, Congressman, the children from Central America comprise a large part of that
yeah.
group from last year, are treated differently than the typical undocumented worker or illegal immigrant.
You mean the OTMs? Is that what you're talking about?
Yes.
I mean, yes. Okay.
Yes. And that was a large part of that. And that's, again, a more expensive proposition when you're dealing with someone from countries that are not on the border. We get as much information as we can. They're treated completely different. We can't expedite their removal. We have to, that we
Madam
turn
Director,
them over.
Madam Director, because both of us have just a little time, I really have a fairly simple question. Do you know what percentage of them were involved with this trade or forced into this trade?
I can't tell you the percentage or an exact number right now, but I do know we glean that kind of information.
Do you have an idea? Could you give us your best estimate?
I don't want to speculate, sir. I really would rather try to find that information for you than to just give you a number off.
Okay.
The
do you think it's a large percentage?
It'll be a. I think it'll be significant.
Yes.
I can't say that. I don't want to quibble on words.
Okay.
But
it's not a meaningless. I mean, heavens, if it's a few, it's a
yes,
lot.
Of
but
course.
This is more than that. This is a, and I'm wondering what steps you're taking to try and. Educate the American people what's happening there, and B, what can we do to protect these children? Because either way, we're putting them in harm's way.
Well, one of the things that I have personally done in my 3+ months is I've been to Central America. I did a round there and to Mexico City to meet with my counterparts, the immigration officials there, to make very clear the president's view, the secretary's view, and my own view that this is not a good thing, and that we would like to work with them to come up with some programs to help those governments deal with their children and keep them there. The First Lady of Guatemala, for example, is the person who deals mostly with the children, the child problem of those people that are coming to the north. And she has programs in place, and we met with the director of those directors of those programs to educate parents there in their countries, because this is what you want first. You don't want them making that trek.
Yeah.
And to let them know it's not only is it dangerous, but that we can provide you some fundamental services.
Yeah.
So we're working with all three governments, Ecuador, Guatemala, and Honduras, and trying our best to...
Let me conclude with this. We're having a nearly 60% increase going on 3 years and probably 4 years now. And I know this wasn't under your watch, but it's under this administration's watch, and we have to do better than that. We can't be in July and August like we were last year, completely unprepared and, I think, encouraging an activity that's very destructive for these younger people. Having said that, thank you for what you do. I hope you understand why this is such a concern to the Americans. Mr. Young, again, thank you for giving me your time. Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Mr. Young.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Director Saldana, I want to reread that quote from the president on February 25th at Florida International University, when he said, "There may be individual ICE officials or Border Patrol who aren't paying attention to our new directives, but they're going to be answerable to the head of the Department of Homeland Security because he's been very clear about what our priority should be. If somebody's working for ICE and there's a policy and they don't follow the policy, there are going to be consequences for it." What did you think about when the president said that and when you learned about it? Did that concern you at all? Did you have any red flags go up at all?
I'm trying to be honest with you, sir. No. I imagine you have staff that you expect to comply with your directives and your policies. I imagine the typical employer in the United States has employees who they expect to follow their directives, their policies. I've got an employee manual this big that says if you violate one of our employment policies, here's the range of punishment you can have. So, no, it didn't strike me as unusual.
Well, if I had policies or directives that were contrary to the law, I would understand if they didn't want to follow them. And so I would expect them to follow the law first.
And that's where you and I probably have a fundamental disagreement.
Oh, okay. Don't you see how some may, in the DHS personnel, perceive that as perhaps a threat, including you maybe, who simply want to obey the law?
A threat? I am here of my own volition and will. I'm just trying to help the United States of America and our country on issues that are so divisive. It doesn't worry me if somebody wants to fire me because I'm not doing what they want to do. I have a great state to return to and a home there. So, no, I'm not threatened by it, and I trust our employees are not. I've spoken to many of them. I plan to visit as many of our offices as I can to explain that to them.
Well, I think that the public record contradicts that, with some of your employees are feeling like they're being retaliated against or threatened. Lawsuits, perhaps. I want to quote President of the National ICE Council, Chris Crane, saying that the agency leadership is, quote, punishing law enforcement officers who are just trying to uphold the U.S. law and willing to take away their retirement, their job, their ability to support their families in favor of someone who is here illegally and violating our laws, either taking a disciplinary action or threatening disciplinary action.
I've met with Mr.
That's
Crane.
That's serious.
Yes. And I've met with Mr. Crane. We actually have had positive meetings because we're both working together to try to get our ERO people on a parity level with respect to their employment, immigration enforcement agents and deportation officers. And we hope we have accomplished that. But I'm not going to get in the middle of pending litigation. I cannot comment further on that, but I want to work with Mr. Crane and with our labor partners to try to make things better for our employees. In the end, the most important thing in accomplishing our mission is our employees, and that they feel like they have an ability to do their jobs and for me to provide the tools they need for that, and I'm working very hard to do that.
Well, you mentioned the labor leaders as well, and as you know, Chris Cabrera also has concerns as well.
with Local 3307, and I'm not going to get into his what he's been saying, but there are concerns out there, as you know. But, you know, this also gets down, this is serious stuff, and this also gets down to, I think, the morale of the whole department. We've had these discussions with Secretary Johnson as well. There seems to be just a real lowest in the administration, I think, is this at the Department of Homeland Security. What are you doing to try to increase that, and what are you doing to try to stand up and protect your personnel who may feel intimidated here at times with policies and directives when they believe they themselves are just trying to uphold the Constitution and obey the law? How do you support them? How do you help increase the morale there in this very, very important agency? And you have a very important job, and I respect you immensely. I want what's best for this country as well and for your employees.
Thank you, sir. I have actually done a lot in the 3 months that I've been there. I started with, as I think I told you, the chiefs, but I also am trying to get to as many offices as I can to meet with people and listen, just listen, make notes, and come back and see what I can do about concerns and complaints there are. I've launched a professional development program where I want to make sure that our people, as I said earlier, are given the tools they need, the resources that you all have a lot to do with in order to do their jobs, and so importantly, that information technology that they need to communicate with each other and with local law enforcement. We have a group, and I'm exploring further the possibility of having a group of field office directors, supervisors, and other folks to come in regularly to visit with me so I can stay in touch with the field and not get surrounded by this, what do you call it? What do you call Washington, D.C.? How can I be nice about this?
The island surrounded by reality?
Exactly. I need a touch of reality because you can get knee-deep in things that aren't as important as serving the American public. And so I'm doing all of those things not for my own personal glory, but because I think this agency needs a lot of institutional practices, best practices that will stay even after I'm long gone.
Well, I appreciate you being here today, and I also appreciate your leadership, and I would just ask that those folks within your agency, when they believe that they're doing the right thing under the law and under the Constitution, and they feel intimidated, that you stand up for them, and I appreciate you being here today. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Ms. Robles, she would like to be recognized for just a moment.
Thank you. Director, I just want to clarify a point on your earlier response on the relationship between the law and the president's policies. The fundamental disagreement to which you referred was whether the policies are consistent with the law. And your position is that the president's policies are entirely consistent with the law? Is that correct?
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Okay. Of course. And again, I'm not saying this because I'm a constitutional expert or anything like that, but I do know that the Department of Justice scoured the requests of and the information submitted to them for a general counsel opinion on whether or not things they were doing were or proposing to do were within the confines of the law. And they got a yay on some, and they got a nay on others, and that the president proceeded along with the secretary to proceed with the ones that were within the confines of the law. I that's all I know is enforcing law. That's all I know.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Culberson, thank you.
Mr. Culberson.
Of course, thank you. Madam Secretary, thank you very much for being here today. Your budget request this year is for $6.282 billion in discretionary funding and mandatory fee authority that, as you say in your testimony, is in lines of the fiscal year 15 enacted budget. How do you use, for example, the discretionary portion of the funding that you receive from the Congress?
How?
Yes, ma'am. For what different purposes within the agency's operations do you use the discretionary funding versus fees, starting with the discretionary?
I'm sorry. Go ahead. Our core mission, and that is, I think I mentioned them a little earlier, the enforcement part, the investigations, the international folks that we have, the management and administration people who keep us all in proper facilities, keep the phones working, and keep us supplied with things.
What I was driving at is you use the discretionary portion of the funding that you receive then primarily for administrative functions in the...
No, to accomplish our core mission.
Accomplish your core mission. Are they distributed...
Supported by our administrative function.
And what amount of the $6.282 billion is discretionary versus mandatory fee?
From what I see here, it is
$5.959 is, where's that money come
this
from?
This is for 16. This is the discretionary.
$5.959 is discretionary money that does not come from fees?
Right. The fees part of it is included in the $322,000, which comprises $6.28 together.
Okay, so the fees
are very small.
So the fees are only a very small part. So your discretionary funding from that, of course, comes from Congress.
It's how we run the agency.
Is the overwhelming majority of your funding.
Right. Our sister agency, Citizenship and Immigration Services, has a large part of its funding from fees, but
right.
We don't.
Right. So your portion of discretionary funding, you said, is 5.959, and then the remainder is from fees, and your sister agency draws what portion of their funding from fees?
Oh, sir, I'm sorry, I'm having a hard enough time with my own budget.
Sure.
I haven't kept up with CIS.
Now the funding, the card that y'all have there, that is, I'd be very interested to see.
Would
that.
Would you like
May
it?
I? Yes. Corey, could you get that for me? Now, that's your officers are using that today in the field to help give them guidance.
Yes,
on
sir.
The
it's following. Essentially the November 20th memorandum of the secretary, but reduced to a simple card.
I see. So there, I've seen these before, and you know, coming from Texas, we work very closely together with all our colleagues that have live up and down the and represent folks up and down the river, and we've seen something like this before. So this is to help your agents enforce the November 20th.
Right.
Directives.
In addition to all the training that we've done and continue to do, that was accomplished back in January before we kicked off the program.
Right. So you're using this today. Their officers in the field are using this today.
Yes.
And putting it into effect today.
Right. And I've charged the field office directors and all the supervisors, you know, to be available for questions. Obviously, our legal, our OPLA people, our office of the legal advisors are also available for questions.
Right, proceeding to enforce, to continue to enforce.
Right,
the
that's
November
just a
20th.
Shorthand way
yeah, no,
to carry
I understand.
In your pocket.
What concerns me, though, is that you're under an injunction. You can't enforce or follow through on the November 20th memorandum because the district judge in South Texas, Judge Hainan, is before the Fifth Circuit on Friday. You're under a temporary injunction not to enforce the November 20th. Memorandum, but you just told me your agents are in the field using this card to enforce the November 20th memorandum.
I think there may be some confusion. That decision, Judge Hainan's decision, is that what you're referring to? Is relates to extended DACA, the children, the admissibility of children, and extended DAPA. That's a program administered by Citizenship and Immigration Services, our sister agency. We are very, our enforcement priorities were not one bit affected by that decision. It was simply whether or not the administration could proceed with extending DACA and initiating the parents part of it, the DAPA program.
Mm-hmm.
And that's CIS. Now,
right,
we had...
The home, the homepage for Homeland Security says it does not affect the December... excuse me, the 2012 DACA initiative, but it enjoins the November 20th memorandum.
There were like 8 or 9 memorandums that day.
They were enjoined, right?
No, sir. No, just the one that dealt with establishing a DAPA program with respect to the lawful presence of parents
mm-hmm.
Of undocumented immigrants and the extension of the DACA program, which initially was just limited to a certain number of people, and it was proposed to be expanded. Mm-hmm. That specifically is what was enjoined. The way ICE, my agency, was affected was very little with respect to that, because I think we had posters in our field offices that said, you may be able to qualify for this. Mm-hmm. Here's information on where to go at CIS. But we're enforcement. Yeah, we don't do administration of benefits like CIS does, mm-hmm. which is what is at the heart of the Judge Hainan's decision.
So you're not bound in any way by Judge Hainan's decision, in your opinion?
We are with respect to those two or three areas where we had posters up. We took them down because we didn't want to be seen to be promoting the program with respect while the injunction is still being litigated. And it's CIS that carries the brunt of that decision. And the Secretary has made very clear, and it is on the website, that the enforcement aspect and the priorities, and if you read the opinion, you will find, are not affected. We proceed with those.
Mm-hmm. What in the budget request you've submitted to us is necessary, obviously, for you to fulfill your mission to enforce the law. But you were saying earlier that you felt you didn't have enough funds to enforce the law. You have to use your discretion, obviously, as a prosecutor. Is the request then insufficient? I mean, trying to get a handle on if you're prioritizing your resources because you don't have enough. Does the fiscal year 16 budget request?
I'm very, very pleased with it, sir. I would not. It has some increases, but it also reflects some efficiencies that we've been able to accomplish with some hard work. And I can't take credit for that. It's the people behind me who should.
So your request would enable you to enforce the law fully?
Absolutely, sir.
Okay. One final question. What is ambiguous? If I don't see that it's ambiguous, the requirement that you use not less than 34,000 detention beds. That's statutory in the Homeland Security bill.
Yes,
mandatory.
I have the language right here.
Right.
It says, provided further that funding made available under this heading shall maintain a level of not less than 30.
Is there anything about that that's discretionary or optional?
No, we have maintained that capacity.
Right, but you're not using it. Right now you're at about 26,000.
Well, that's dictated, sir, by the flow of immigrants. As you know, Customs and Border...
There's no shortage of folks coming over the border illegally.
Right, and we need to apprehend them and find them. But what I'm saying is, as you know, at the border, apprehensions are down. The first line of defense is CBP. It is down about 24%. So that's going to obviously affect, since we get about 60% of our beds from... or our apprehensions from CBP, that's going to affect that. Plus, it's seasonal. This is a seasonal flow, and we're just getting to the warmer months where there's the migration patterns in the past have shown us there might be an increase in migration.
So is it optional for you to use those 34,000 beds, in your opinion?
Optional? It's not optional to have them available.
But it's optional whether or not you use them?
It's not optional, sir. We have those, and we will use them to the extent we make decisions that someone needs to be detained. If you're asking me whether it's more important to fill a bed than it is to do it right, I have to go with doing it right. And that is make our decisions on the basis of, just like the federal courts do.
Yeah. I'll close with this. Now, thank you for the extra time, Mr. Chairman. But if it's not clear, I mean, we're as policymakers and statute drafters wrote this so it is not ambiguous, it's not discretionary, it's not optional. We want you to use 34,000 beds.
That's absolutely
demand. That's plenty of demand.
Absolutely clear to me, but sir, we don't detain people just for the heck of it. We detain people based on what the law tells us, and that is this person a flight risk, and is this person a threat to public safety? And those are the decisions that our very seasoned officers out there are making every day.
Mm-hmm.
And from what I have seen and observed, they're making the right decisions.
Well, I feel very confident you could find an extra 9,000 criminal aliens that needed to be detained to fill those beds in a heartbeat.
We're working on that. That was part of what Operation Crosscheck was.
But you feel like this does not require to use the beds, so I think perhaps the language might need a little tweaking. Thank you.
I, well, I, That's not what I intended. I said it is capacity. In my view,
well, the President thinks statutes
there
are optional and subject to his discretion, and he's obligated by the Constitution to take care that the laws be faithfully executed. He's clearly in violation of that. You've told us you don't think this policy that the President's issued is in contrary to the law. We as policymakers and legislators and here to the law enacted by Congress is what the President and the agencies are to follow, not a policy directive or a memorandum sent out by the head of an agency. It is the law enacted by Congress that you and the President are obligated to follow. And there's just a fundamental disagreement here. And I think it's at the root of what has outraged the country, quite frankly, from coast to coast, is that the President systematically and repeatedly refuses to enforce the law as written, and you've just confirmed that for us today. It's upsetting and concerning because we in Texas feel the brunt of this with the number of criminal aliens coming across the border, the drug runners, the killers, the sex traffickers. It's appalling and outrageous, and no one is more worried about it than the communities that, for example, our good friend Henry Cuellar represents along the Rio Grande River.
And that I have a home in.
Nuevo Laredo is a ghost town, as you know. It's a terrible situation. So we expect you to follow the law as written, and when something says shall, it's not optional. Thank you for your time.
And I didn't say that, sir. I really said in my view.
You feel like you don't need to use them.
No, sir. We're working to use them. We're every day people are out there trying to find, particularly with respect to persons with criminal records and those that meet our priorities, we're trying to find those folks if we aren't handed them to us by CBP. To me, the important thing is to make the right decisions as required by law as to whether we can detain someone or not. It's not the sole purpose and goal is not to fill a bed. It's to fill it in the right way. That's my view.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I have a lot of things I'd like to talk about, but this is very disconcerting. In the world that I grew up in, one of the things we prided ourselves with is that we have an independent executive department, we have an independent legislative department, we have an independent judiciary. As part of the judicial system, you have prosecutors. Their job is to prosecute those people charged with a crime by indictment or by information, depending on what level of court system you're in. These are very simple. I think it would be, and let's narrow it down to the state level for just a moment, which mirrors the United States government, supposedly. I think it would be shocking for the governor of the state of Texas to be telling police officers and sheriffs to make a decision as to whether or not to release people based upon his directive. You shall release the following people because these are people I don't think should be arrested. Okay, now follow me on this. You are a prosecutor, part of supposedly an independent judiciary, but in reality what we're saying here is it's not really independent. It's dependent upon what the President directs how you should prosecute and directs. Where I believe in that there is discretion in a prosecutor's office. It's the prosecutor's discretion, not the governor's discretion. It's the prosecutor's discretion. Their decisions are made upon the availability of the court, the seriousness of the offense, the threat to public safety, and all of these things, which are common sense things that we expect our law enforcement people and our prosecutors to have. Yes, cops make certain decisions as who to arrest and who not to arrest under certain circumstances, but not because somebody had directed them to ignore the law and do that, but because we trust our police officers to determine the extant circumstances of the arrest and what they're dealing with, and to make those decisions. Not because the governor of the state of Texas tells Officer Jones in Ozona, Texas, I don't want you arresting anybody for drug cases because I like to smoke marijuana. I'm making that up. That's silliness. But at some point in time, varying the way the system is supposed to work, the variations can be carried to the ridiculous. And the trust that the American people have in the government, especially the federal government, is diminishing worse in the last 6 years than it's diminished in the history of the Republic. Because people say, wait a minute, what does a bunch of people in the White House get to say about following the law? The law, as far as the immigration law is concerned, recent border crossings shall be detained.
Absolutely.
Now, there's a reason for that. You know why we detain people. You're a prosecutor. Yeah, I bet you've made speeches to your juries when you're talking to them. You know, putting these people in prison, it deters others from doing it. It punishes them for doing it. There's all these things. And it protects society. You make those arguments every time you walked into the courtroom almost. I almost guarantee it. Now, that's what we expect. If we follow what the logic of directives from the White House into the judicial system of the United States, telling you what laws you should and should not enforce, not use your discretion to do it, no, that's different. No, you shall do this because I told you to, and there will be consequences if you don't. That is different than prosecutorial discretion or officer discretion. That is being ordered at risk of losing your job, losing your pension, and losing other things. We are going to hurt you if you don't do what I say. Now, you know, we had a guy named King George we had some problems with on those issues. Okay? But I just can't help but I want someone to explain where that's different than what it's supposed to be. And this is not about the department right now. This is about the philosophical difference in the view of the government. And I've run into people literally every day that say, what are you going to do about the lawlessness? You're an old judge. You stood for the law in our county for 20 years. Why aren't you doing something about the lawlessness in Washington? Now, this is just prosecutor to member, the former member of the, actually, I'm still a retired member of the judiciary. What do you think about that? Because you see, this is the executive branch telling the judicial officers how to do their job.
I see this as, this is what is so profoundly confusing to me, why we are ships passing in the night here on this subject. I see this as an extension of what I did as the United States Attorney. I knew I had so many millions of dollars to protect almost 10 million people in North Texas in 100 counties, and that I had so many employees, and that I had 3,000 plus laws to enforce. In order to make sense out of who is going to hurt who has the possibility to hurt my community more, there were people I would have loved for our folks to prosecute who we just couldn't reach. I had to make decisions on prosecutorial guidelines.
Okay, well, wait a minute. I agree with everything you say. You are a prosecutor. But that ICE agent sitting out there, he's not a prosecutor. He's a cop. Okay? Are we expanding now the discretion of enforcing the laws of the United States down to our law enforcement officers? Does the constable in my local county have the ability to make the decision that he's not going to enforce the law and call it prosecutorial discretion? At what point do we stop taking this from our created constitutional system and putting it in the hands of the individual? Because quite honestly, I don't think we want the king making that decision, and I don't think we want cops making that decision.
This is not much different from what they've done every day, Mr. Chairman. They have, even before executive action, we train them to use their best judgments with respect to the people they find. And law enforcement, in the end, their primary interest is protect the community. And the question is, if you've only got so much money, how are you going to, where are you going to focus your resources? It makes eminent sense.
Okay, then let them make those decisions, but don't let the President of the United States threaten their jobs, their pensions, and their lives if they don't do it the way he wants to do it. That's the problem we've got with this system. It's none of his business how an ICE agent operates unless he's operating outside the law. If you're saying the ICE agent gets discretion. If a sheriff's deputy gets discretion, that's between him and the sheriff, but it's not between him and the county judge or the district judge telling him, sorry, cop, here's how you want you to make your arrests. That's not the way our system's supposed to work. That's my concern. I'm going to get off of that. But that's why people at home are so upset, and that's why a lot of us are upset. I want to go to one. I'm going to be very quickly. Let's talk about your hiring challenges, because quite honestly, that money from this budget doesn't look like it's going to get used, and we're asking for more for the next budget, and we need to know how you expect that to work, and if you're not going to use that money for that purpose, are you going to ask for us to move that money someplace else?
Something that's gotten my attention, and that's exactly what you're talking about. The hiring, we up till 2 months ago, we were under the specter of shutdown and sequestration, and it's not as if you can go out and hire people under those circumstances. Nobody, I'm not sure who would be interested in taking a job where they don't even know if they're going to have one. But we did what we did do, though, and we're pedaling as fast as we can. What we did do is we started people in the pipeline, started interviewing, getting information, applications, geared up our classes in order to train people before they hit the job, and we are working very hard at it. We've got the balance of this year, and then obviously we're asking for these additional people the next year. I believe very sincerely that with oversight, and that's on me, that we can get through that process, which is cumbersome in the United States of America with federal employment. It just is, especially with law enforcement officers who have special security requirements and as it should be, and training that they're required to have. So the minute we knew we were going to have an appropriation, we geared back up, I think we're going to be prepared to meet our 15 hiring. At least it may spill over a little bit into 16, but I believe we'll get that all done before the end of 16. I think we'll use that money, and that's why we're asking for it. Yes, sir. Those
requesting us to make a change, because I mean, you have that ability to ask us to shift funds to other programs.
Okay.
We'd like to know what those are.
Okay, sir. We'll keep that in mind, and we'll keep you apprised as quickly as we can as we see that pattern developing.
We expect them to be hired, and I can understand the argument on the fiasco we were in a while back, and that it wasn't my doing. I can understand the argument on the fiasco we did had a while back, and it wasn't my doing. Ms. Rober-Allard.
Okay. Well, not to belabor the previous discussion, I just want to, again, have some clarification. I would agree with the chairman and other members of the committee if the decisions that we're talking about were decisions that were just made in isolation and, the executive branch came up with an idea and then tried to enforce it on ICE or any of the other agencies. But it is my understanding that before these decisions are made, either through executive order or whatever, is that they are fully vetted through constitutional lawyers, through the Justice Department, to make sure whether they fall within the law of what the president can and cannot do. So if that is not the case, then I would like some information on when that has not happened. And I don't want it, not necessarily for right now, but my understanding that these executive actions have been fully vetted, gone through constitutional lawyers, and in many cases the decision has been said, no, you can't do this, and it has not been done.
Yes, that's a 33-page opinion from the Office of General Counsel, and it It's very thorough and complete. It certainly satisfies me that those actions are within the law. I mean,
okay. And then I have another point of clarification. When I was, I asked the questions about the hunger strikers at Carnes and whether or not the participants had been offered release on bond, and I believe your response was that that they were given bond determination, and my understanding that bond determination can be no bond, and we have staff that has met with several of the families that were involved on these hunger strikes, about four families, and they were not given a bond amount. So.
Well, let's not put the cart before the horse. The first decision is whether to detain or not. And if a decision is made not to detain, then the opportunity for bond comes up. Families are no different from adults. They have to satisfy the person making the decision that they're not a flight risk or a threat to the community. I do not know the four specific families you're talking about, but they might not have been given a bond opportunity if the decision was made with respect to those two elements. But they all know, and many, many, many take advantage of, if we our detention decisions or our specific bond decisions, they can appeal to the court, the immigration courts, to lower the bond, change the bond, remove the bond, and reverse the detention decision for that matter. So as I said, I'm happy to visit with you about that. They either fall into that category. I don't know the four in particular you're talking about, but they either fall into that category where a decision was made that they should be detained and they didn't appeal. But if the decision was made, yes, you can be released, you're not a flight risk, but we want you to appear in the future, we're going to set this bond. That should have happened, and that's what.
So some potential could be for example, these four were not offered bond, and maybe I don't want to take up the committee time now, but I would like to follow up.
Absolutely.
On that as to what the reasons were, because as I mentioned earlier, there was also allegations of mistreatment and other things that I'd like to follow up with you on.
Okay, thank you, Congressman.
Last November, the Secretary issued a memo directing the implementation of the Priority Enforcement Program, which is intended to take the place of secure communities. And the PEP program relies on the voluntary cooperation of local law enforcement agency. My question is that based on ICE efforts so far, have you found that state and local jurisdictions are willing to provide the advance notifications? And if not, what are the stumbling blocks to their participation? And then finally, what is the current status of implementing the program, and when will it be fully?
I'm very anxious. People have been working around the clock. The forms, the request for notification, this is essentially a new form, as opposed to a detainer request, I am told, finalized. Everyone, including NGOs, had an opportunity to review them and make comments, and we've been tweaking and changing. I think that'll be imminent. And our hope is that we can do a form, and we need those forms before we go to the jurisdiction and say, here's the form. That hasn't stopped us from visiting with them. And the Secretary and I actually have made joint visits, at least one joint visit, and we're spreading out across the country to visit with folks. I think I made the offer with you to come to your jurisdiction, too. They're listening. There is a long history, as you well know, with respect to this the Secure Communities Program and the trust. And so we're doing our best to try to work on that and rebuild trust. So we're hopeful. We're hopeful that jurisdictions, because we all have the same interest in mind, bottom line, and that's public safety. I am hopeful that the program will be kicked off the ground formally before the end of the month.
But is your experience that they're more receptive to this than?
We've just started our campaign of going across the country, but we nobody has slammed the door on us.
Okay. to ensure that under the PEP there's going to be transparency with regards to ICE's request for notification, will ICE include the immigration enforcement priority that is the basis for the request?
You know, as I was saying, people have been reviewing that form, and I know that was a subject of some debate, and I can't remember finally what it was. As soon as we finalize that, we can certainly make it available to you. I just can't remember if we ended up with that in there or not.
Okay. And finally, is last November's memo from the Secretary establishing the PEP indicated that detainers would only be used in special circumstances, such as when there is sufficient probable cause to find that the person is a removable alien. Is ICE still issuing detainers, and who makes the determination as to whether sufficient probable cause exists to justify the use of the detainer?
It's the officer. Some jurisdictions are requesting that a federal judge get involved in these decisions. I can't even imagine, with the way the courts are overloaded as it is, that a federal judge is going to want to review an administrative civil enforcement decision to detain. So that's a big stumbling block with some jurisdictions. You might have asked another question that I've failed to answer. Were there two or three questions there? I can't remember.
There were several, but I think you may have answered. I've already turned the page.
So. Okay.
During last year's hearing, I asked about the status of expanding compliance with the 2011 performance-based national detention standards to more facilities housing ICE detainees. And the deputy director stated that he had asked ERO and the ICE CFO to develop an execution plan that would take into account any increased per diem costs associated with requiring detention facilities to meet the standards. What is the status of requiring detention facilities used by ICE to adhere to the 2011 performance-based national detention standards, and do you expect to eventually get to 100% compliance for all facilities housing ICE detainees, including ICE facilities, contract facilities, and facilities housing detainees under an intergovernmental agreement?
Of course, with respect to our facilities that we run ourselves, we're there and we are complying with those. It's the contract, as you mentioned earlier, that are the issue, because they have a contract that may run a period of time that doesn't have that provision. We're obviously on top of that. We're expecting them to generally comply, but we will be sure to put that in the contract in the next go-around. The last time I checked, Congresswoman, we were about at 60% or something of compliance among them, and part of that will be the people who we're going to have to renew their contracts and put it in there. But it's something that's very much reviewed. The standards that are applied, that's part of our monitoring, review, and auditing process. We're checking all the time and making corrective action where there are issues. That's the status.
Okay. Do you have a schedule as to what you hope to have full compliance?
I don't have one written now, but you know what I can do is check into that executive action, execution plan you mentioned earlier, and see where we are and provide that to you.
Okay. And as contracts
included
come up, that would have to be included. They would not get a contract unless they were compliant?
Well, they'd have to agree to come into compliance, yes. We wouldn't say to someone who refused to.
But would there be then a timeline? In other words, if you know, they can say, yes, we'll comply, give us the contract, and then just drag it out until, you know, the end of that contract. So what would be the conditions under which someone who was currently in violation of not meeting the standards, what would be the timeline which they had to until that contract would be revoked?
We probably have to make that decision on a contract-by-contract basis, but it stands to reason that we're going to be approaching that with, this needs to be done within a certain period of time. Negotiations, I can't represent to you that it'll be done within a month of signing the contract, but it's certainly at the very highest level of attention when it comes to our new contracts.
So would those that are in, are compliant, would they have priority over those that were not yet compliant?
Are you thinking there's a highly competitive situation out there for people to run detention centers because that
they make
that really,
a lot of money?
Yeah, they do, but they don't. But it doesn't. It's not palatable to. We don't have people knocking down the doors to come and run our facilities, unfortunately.
Okay, I could just
follow. All right, well, I think that concludes this hearing. Thank you for being here. We enjoy visiting with you, and we'll be visiting with you again soon.
Oh, I'm sure. Thank you, sir.
Come see us. We're adjourned.